Welcome to Hibis Conversations. It is not every day that you get to discuss adventure in its purest form. We have with us today a club that dominates the adventure landscape in Hyderabad, the Great Hyderabad Adventure Club. Set up in 2008 by Diyanat Ali, an avid trekker himself, today the club boasts of more than 35,000 members with more than 5,000 trek done. And that is a big achievement in itself, because going back to nature and learning from nature are the most important things one can do. And in adventure, as in life, nothing is predictable, and that makes it all the more thrilling. To discuss this and more, we have with us Mr. Diyanat Ali, the founder of Great Hyderabad Adventure Club. Welcome to the show, Diyanat. One of the first questions I want to ask you is very simple, is what motivated you to set up this club?
Thank you, Suresh. Pleasure to be here on this channel. As I look back, my motivation comes from very early childhood and being born and brought up in area like Banjara Hills with a lot of rocks, trees, and my favorite pastime after school was just go out into the rocks, play there, you know, get into a cave with a lot of friends. And I was also fortunate to have a lot of horses at home, goats at home, rabbits at home. So a lot of connection with nature, and that was very much into my growing up until I was, you know, moved to Secunderabad, and that's what got into my blood. I always say adventure and nature is in my blood since childhood.
So when you decided to start this club, the Great Hyderabad Adventure Club, I remember, because I'm also a member of the club, I was an active member at least a few years ago, still when age caught up with me and my work got better of me. But I guess knowing the Great Hyderabad Adventure Club, I remember you telling us that, you know, when you started, you were alone technically. And even one of the treks that you're supposed to go to Annapurna Peak or somewhere, and you went alone again, but you had some friends later on. Can you describe to us the early days of this club, how tough it was to get people, convincing people to come for treks?
Lovely. As I hear you, I remember the fond memories and the conversations I had with you. When I started this club, I was working for an IT company, and after a 5-day job, weekends were usually into movies, pubs and all. Somewhere I didn't like that culture, and I wanted to do something that I was very passionate about. The next thing that came up to me very naturally was adventure and outdoors. And then I started going out with my friends from 2004 onwards on weekends. It was difficult to get people to go out in the outdoors. Very handful few people used to come with me. And later on I decided that I need to, you know, share this passion with the city of Hyderabad. And at the time when I discussed with a lot of people, everybody used to say this idea won't work because Hyderabad is a laid back, nobody is going to join you anywhere. And whenever I called either a cousin or a friend, he say, can we go in the morning? We are starting at 6. They would say, nahi hota boss, 11 baje ja rahe to bolo. And that created a little sense of disappointment in me. But I thought, I have to do something, and I have to do something big. And that is what I decided. I will do something big so that it creates an attention for people. And then I said, I am going to the Annapurna base camp. And I announced it. And I waited for a month for people to join in. Okay, people discussed, they showed interest, nobody came. And I went alone all the way to Nepal. I found some local friends there. I completed that trek and I came back. And after that, I announced local treks and all. And I could see that many people used to say that they would come, they will join me, and they will not show up. I was the only guy out there, either waiting at Durgam Cheru or waiting at Maulali. And then I thought something more needs to be done out there. And I came with different strategies based on what people were bringing excuses. Some of them said, we are not able to get up in the morning. So I thought, okay, I will wake you up in the morning. So then I get up at 4 o'clock. My job was to sit for half an hour, call those guys, give them enough time to wake up, and then I'll go to that point, wait. One or two will show up, others will not show up. And that was a continuous thing. Then I thought more needs to be done. I thought, okay, let me call them in the evening and then just before they sleep, and also in the morning. Then that worked a bit. you know, half of the people, 2-3 people used to come, but others were still having difficulty. Then I thought, okay, let me try something else. And I said, okay, when they signed up, I said, give me your address. Then I started from my home in my car, go to their home, knock their door, wait till they, you know, dress up and, you know, go with them to that particular area, either Durgam Cheru, do the rock climbing, trekking, hiking, come back, drop them. And that's how we had the first group of 10 people.
So, not many people know that groups like the Great Hyderabad Adventure Club are on a platform called Meetup. It's a kind of a platform that allows you to put up different activities, accept payments for that, put all kind of instructions, and once you come back, you can even share the pictures of where you went trekking. But growing up from there, I remember when I joined GHAC, we used to go out on treks to smaller destinations nearby. And later on, as GHAC progressed, people went to the Everest Base Camp. Some of them tried to go to the other places like Mount Elbrus, and some of them did Kanchenjunga, some of them did various places, Annapurna and others. So the question was about fitness, the level of fitness, because trekking or going on an adventure is not just fun and games. It's about also your level of fitness. You know how much you can do, and I remember talking about this, because when you go to climb an Everest base camp, you know, as you keep climbing up, the oxygen level keeps depleting, and you need to kind of rest, come down a bit, and then go up again, and that also the load that you carry on you. So some people used to put bricks in a bag and then climb up to know how much capacity you can carry. That used to happen at Maulali and other places. But I'm sure Dia, you can recollect those early days in terms of trying to be fit to do this kind of more, I'm not calling it exotic, but higher and tougher climbs.
Yeah, as I hear you, Suresh, I remember all the fond memories, especially fitness. And you mentioned that going to such places requires a great amount of fitness. We have to prepare for the journey. So the way we used to do is, any member who would like to go to any place like the Everest Base Camp or the Annapurna Base Camp, they need to come in and sign up 3 months before they used to go there. And every week, every Sunday, we used to take them on different treks. And we had some beautiful hillocks in around Hyderabad, the Maulali, Amoguda, Durgam Cheru. And I remember, you know, going with these members to do fitness, to prepare ourselves. And we used to climb Maulali 5 or 6 times, and they were like 500 steps. 2500, you know, steps, and that created a lot of fitness. So what we're trying to do essentially is to simulate the climbing, and most of the climbing out there is hill climbing, okay, and a majority of fitness has to be your leg work. You know, you're going to push yourself, and when you're carrying a backpack of 10 to 15 kgs, you know, majority of the work is the legs, hands it's not much, and you need a lot of stamina, and your cardiovascular system has to be good. You already mentioned that, you know, oxygen level is low there. So your breathing and the way you breathe has to be free. So all these things are done over here, and these members become fit, and becoming fit gives a lot of confidence to them that yes, we'll be able to do this 10-day journey of walking 8 to 10 hours through a lot of hills. And when the hills, it's very different. The weather can change there any time. Okay, it could rain, it could become cold, you know, it can become hot in the day. So also being ready to adapt to that part, and therefore, you know, preparation is the key. And because of preparation, I would say that we had never had any accidents or anybody who had to return back. So that's, I think fitness is a major thing that we would look into the preparation.
Any trek that is done often requires a leader to lead the trek, somebody who's experienced, been there, done that. To prepare people, it's not easy, because not everybody can become a leader automatically, but some things can be taught. And one of the most wonderful memories that I have of Great Hyderabad Adventure Club, or GHAC as it's popularly known as, is the leadership workshops. Over the years, the club has held numerous leadership workshops and in different places, so that these leaders can be trained in various aspects, including eating from the wild, because sometimes you may be lost, and there have been a couple of instances where it has happened to our trek leaders themselves, but you should know how to survive. I think these are life's lessons, because survival is not just about getting lost in a forest. You can be anywhere lost tomorrow. You can be in the middle of a forest driving through and a vehicle has a puncture and you're kind of stuck. You should know how to survive. At the same time, you should know how to use a rope. For example, how to use a knife. Various things that can be done that are taught in terms of life survival skills. I think, Diyanath, if you can just explain to us, to the viewers of Hybis, as to how these training workshops were conducted and what were the objective behind conducting those workshops.
Wonderful. So, one of the things is outdoors is inherently risky and it can be life threatening when, you know, members of the leaders that doesn't have the skill to face a disaster that could happen. A disaster could be anywhere from a rock fall, it could be, you know, injury that has happened to a member or somebody becoming dizzy and falling down. It could be rain, it could be severe heat, it could be severe cold, and out there it is uncertainty, and the only way to deal with uncertainty is preparation and training. So that's where I came up with this idea of the outdoor leadership workshop, which is primarily done in many of the, you know, institutions in USA and UK, alpine clubs, and without this necessary training, leaders cannot lead the trek. And that's what I thought, that if we have to face uncertainty and if the club has to conduct safe events, then this is a necessary thing. Okay. One more reason was that I was the only person who was leading the treks initially, and I could do only 4 weekends. And then there were a lot of members who were on the wait list, and therefore I thought that training needs to be conducted in outdoor leadership, and my own training was through NCC, and I've been doing rock climbing in NCC, we're doing wilderness survival, trekking and all, and that gave me a lot of experience. So the primary objective of doing the outdoor leadership workshop was to mitigate the risk, and the way we used to do is not just technical skills. Technical skills is very necessary. Okay, how do we deal with uncertain situations, how do we do evacuation, how do we do rescue, and, you know, how do you make shelters, and if you run out of water, how do you access water, how do you filter water, and if you run out of food, okay, if sometimes your backpack falls, then what is it that you can survive on, and what are the priorities in survival. Okay, so we study this in this outdoor leadership workshop, that shelter is most important. Then we look into water, and then we look into food. So food is never a priority there. So all these trainings go into building the leader, so that when he's out there, he has the capability and competency to make decisions and the right decisions to lead safe treks. And the priority there is, of course, enjoyment and recreation is there, but how can we make it safe and non-life threatening? So that was the idea behind the outdoor leadership workshop on the technical part. The second part was on leadership. Okay. Just being technically good doesn't make you, you know, competent enough to lead a group. Because in a group, you get different people with different perceptions, different mindsets. How do you bring a sense of inclusion? How do you motivate them? How do you create agreements together so that everybody works like a team? And that's not an easy part. So a combination of technical skills and leadership skills is what makes our outdoor leaders very unique in the country. And these workshops are not just done in-house with the club. We send our people to the national institutes like NIM and HMI. We invite a lot of army colonels who come here and conduct a lot of workshops for us. So there's a lot of exchange of, you know, technology and knowledge from the industry. And I would say that the most critical and successful factor for the club has been the outdoor leadership trainings, where we're able to take a batch of, you know, 20 to 30 people and work with them, not just in the outdoor leadership workshop, but also, you know, mentoring them. So they would go with an existing leader who's competent enough, and he will handhold this leader on the treks. So it's very real time, it's not bookish. And unless these new leaders demonstrate competence, they're not allowed to lead the treks. And therefore, I feel that outdoor leadership workshops has been a primary, you know, strategy for a club to grow very fast.
I remember attending one of these leadership workshops, because that's how I became a trek leader later on. I think it was the third or fourth, I don't remember exactly. But usually it is held at places like the Dhruva College of Management or at Divya Retreat, so that it gives a forest-like appeal, so that you can learn how to cook, for example, for yourself. The first aid is a very important component, and we had a couple of cases where people had fallen off a side of a cliff, and not too far down, but they were picked up by our own people, brought up due to the training that was given. There was another instance when two of the trek leaders got lost in Karnataka, and they were discovered 4.5 days later, 5 days later, hail, not really hearty, but hail, and they were brought back. But what made them survive was this training that was given to them, because they were told to go to the nearest water body, because you need water to survive. Basically, you can still survive without food, but water is essential. You get dehydrated very fast. So I think what Diana described to you as in a training, I think this is something that should be experienced by everyone. I mean, leadership is not about just sitting in a classroom training, sitting and seeing PowerPoints, and then say that I am a leader. The leadership is when you go out into the forest and you encounter a situation, whereas Diya said somebody breaks a leg, or you encounter a wild animal, or you run out of food and water. What do you do in such a circumstance? That is a true leadership material. That is what makes you a true leader. And that is, I think, one of the great things that GHSE has done. Diya, I mean, going along the way, can you explain to our viewers as to how does one join a trek in GHSE? I mean, what are the ways to go about? I know there's a meetup that, but how do you actually get into the meetup in the first place? How do you decide where to go? And now that the pandemic is on and just coming out of it now, has GHSE resumed their trekking activities?
Yeah. So we are using meetup.com to host our events. We also have a website, ghac.in. For new members, we welcome them to join our local treks, which are 2 to 3 hours. And if you have never been into a trek, this is a good way to start, you know, get used to building up your fitness in a very recreational manner, which is done around the city. And slowly after you've done a couple of them, we invite you to do a day-long program with us, which will be hosted anywhere outside of Hyderabad, in the outskirts, like Mahbub Nagar, Kondamatgu, Bhongir Fort and all. And once you're done a couple of single day ones, your fitness will automatically grow up. You don't have to go to a gym to prepare for it. The outdoors is the best gym for it. And then you can go out with us for an overnight 2 days trip. The most recreational or most enjoyable trips are the overnight, because there you will be camping under the stars, you'll have a sense of bonding with so many different people, you'll be out in the nature for an extended period of 2 to 3 days. And that's how the journey goes. And after that, if you'd like to go for high altitude treks, which are like 7 to 10 days, so there's a gradual progress to it. So you build your fitness, you also learn the technical knowledge, and you have to, you know, get some gear for yourself, a backpack, a trekking boots, and maybe, you know, some gear that you also wear, which is comfortable in different weathers. And accordingly, we give guidance to by all this. So a little bit of preparation is required, but it's not like something that is tough, or it's not like a skill that you need to prepare in a classroom and go. It's, you come there, start small, and then gradually you able to find your own strengths and skills, how you're able to cope, and accordingly you can go and do any of those adventure events. And 90% of our members, you know, they do a lot of trekking, and about 10% would like to go for other adventure events, like adventure sports. It could be skydiving, it could be paragliding. So those options are also open as you go up. And there are a variety of things that you can do all over India, and different terrains. You can go for scuba diving in the Andamans, you can go for, you know, paragliding in Kamshet. So a lot of things open up once you start small. So there's huge potential for you to leverage adventure activities into your life.
Diya, one of the questions often asked by many trekking members, especially when women are involved in trekking, is how safe are they? They are as safe as they are in their homes, because in GHSE, there's a culture of respecting women. Of course, getting children along is not permitted unless they are accompanied by adults, but even then we don't encourage, because many other situations the children may not be able to trek on their own. But there are exceptions for that. I mean, that are smaller treks, they can always join in. But I remember, Diya, this particular fact that many of the leaders of GHSE are actually women, the trek leaders. I mean, that is an encouraging fact. So maybe you can throw a bit of light on that also.
Yeah, I'm just reminded about initially the first year, we were a boys club. It was so difficult for women to join, and the parents used to call me, and some of them actually visited me before they could send their daughter. And once a few of these women joined in, and there was a trust level into it, and I had to list my, you know, home address, I gave my phone number, and I shared a lot about who am I and why I am doing it. And in fact, I celebrated. Well, the first woman who came for the first trek was like, from a boys club we are becoming, you know, a more of a mix gender, and that's what we want, you know, equity and equality and adventure. I mean, adventure is not just for men. A woman are equally capable of doing everything that a man can do, and that was a great celebration. And as we did it, we could see that most of these young women, they have passion, they have the strength, they have the grit, the determination to do this. And they joined up for our outdoor leadership workshops, they went through the training, and many of them are there who run their own companies now. And I can name them, Jamila is one, and Siri is there, we have Jyoti. So more than dozen of these women who have, you know, done trekking, started with the first small trek, with GHSC, and now doing great in their life. They have adopted this as a passion and as a profession. And yeah, I would say that adventure is not just for men, it is equally for women. And I've seen this journey of so many women who went through our club and are doing great in the outdoors and adventure.
In fact, one of the wonderful things about GHSC is that it teaches you to be humble, it teaches you to respect nature, and it also teaches you that how life is struggling when you go to Nepal and eat that dal bhat and other things, because you got to respect nature, because that is the way GHSC functions. We don't litter, definitely we don't throw bottles around, we ensure that we take back everything that we get from our homes. That is one of the most important things. And you live frugally, you don't carry huge amounts of food. And one of the things that Diya of course can talk about is the fact that there is no luxury in adventure. If you are a person who is accustomed to staying in a 5-star hotel or a 3-star hotel or anything, no. You sleep in a cave, you sleep under the literal sky, and you enjoy it. And that's what adventure is all about. So Diya, can you, as a measure of telling people, a kind of a statutory warning, put out this particular fact about what adventure is all about, I mean at least with GHSC?
Yeah, so adventure is about getting close to nature. It is very sensory. You can't sit and watch, you know, adventure. But that may be one way of, you know, looking how others do it. You can do it in a movie. But when you're adventurous, you have to get your hands dirty, you have to get your feet dirty. And there's a pleasure in it. Okay. What I personally believe is any kind of luxury brings separation between the adventure and, you know, the person. And I'm not able to experience it as fully it is. If I'm, you know, looking at adventure, even if I go there and stay in a very luxurious place, then I am not fully immersing into it. That immersive experience is not there. And therefore, adventure is plain as it is, real. And what we do is to get very close to nature, we will remove everything that brings in separation. Okay, so luxury we find is separation. Anything to do with too much preparation also, we find it as like separation. So minimal. Whatever minimal we could do. And there are two intentions behind this. One is to see nature very closely, sensory, from the heart and from the spirit, get immersed into it. Second is to make sure that we don't create an impact on Mother Earth, or the minimal damage that is possible. With this intention, the best way is to be minimalist, you know, use a tent, take only things that you will eat, and bring back all plastics, follow the routes. And we also are very strong no smoking, no drinking club, and we are very safe when it comes to children and women. We follow discipline. I think discipline came in me from my NCC days, when you had boys separate and girls separate. We still follow it until unless you are a couple. Okay, so accommodations are also separate, and leaders are strictly told to maintain this discipline policy. So a lot goes into experiencing, because adventure is about experiencing it very sensorily, okay, very, very close to earth. I mean, we need to touch it, we need to smell it, you need to taste it, you need to hear it, you need to embrace it fully with your spirit and with your body. That's what adventure is. Luxury, I feel, is a barrier. It brings separation. So anybody who would like to get with adventure, go barebone, go minimalist, and that's where you'll be able to get deeply into adventure. And it's not just the outer adventure, you'll also find that there is an inner adventure in you. There's a larger world that comes up. As you mentioned, one way of that is we feel humble. When you look at a mountain, we look at it like an elder. Elder who is wise, who has seen the world, so millions of years. And when you stand in front of such an elder, even as I speak, I get these goosebumps and I'm able to get into that phase again. Feel so humble, you feel so tiny. And that humility, you know, makes you very, very friendly. That makes you understand what life is. It removes your ego. It separates your ego from you. And you just surrender to that magnificent mountain or the wisdom or the nature. You can even see the divine in the mountain. You can even see the divine in the nature. That makes you fully surrender and just be one with it. So ultimately, it is one. You don't say that the mountain is separate. I am with the mountain and I am the mountain. We are all one.
So that you see in Nepal, actually, when you go there, you know, there's peaks and all that. Nepal is literally worship the mountains as God and goddesses and all that. But as Dia was telling you, you know, one of the main things about climbing a mountain, and I think George Mallory, was it, who was asked, why did you climb Mount Everest? And he had a very smart answer. He said, because it's there. And that is the most important thing, you know. It is not just in climbing the mountain, but on reaching on top of it and being there. Because that takes away all the tiredness. And I remember doing this trek in Mathiaran for the first time with Deepam sir. Halfway through, I had to come back because I couldn't stand, I couldn't really go ahead. And you know, I had to return back to the base, take a train to Neral, and then from there to Mathiaran and reach the hotel. And mothers trekked the way up. But second time when I went better prepared. I had prepared myself despite my age and I climbed it. And Mathiaran still remains my favorite trekking place. And I'm sure Dia, as we end this conversation, also has a list of places which he loves to go. I'm sure all of us love to go to different places. I mean, one need not really go to Mount Everest because not everybody climb Mount Everest. Not everybody has the kind of money to climb Mount Everest. You remember, even if you're fit. But the most important thing is enjoying the small things. Even if it's Anantagiri Hills right here in Hyderabad, which is just about a couple of hours driving from here. And that is the thrill, that you go there, sit quietly and listen to nature and enjoy that beautiful moments that are there. I'm sure Dia has a list of places that he loves to go.
Yeah, I remember I did a lot of exploration. I listed down 100 places around Hyderabad. And when people used to say, where can we go in Hyderabad? I said, I have 100 places. And I knew that out of these places, Anantagiri was, you know, my favorite one. And I knew that there were some places were inaccessible for people. And I kept them like secret. I guarded them. I didn't take many people out there. And I still know that there are parts of it which are so pristine and beautiful. And apart from Anantagiri, I roamed around the state of Andhra Pradesh. We went to Gandikota, we explored the old forts there. There's a river there, you know, the Penna River. It's beautiful. We did this in 2009 and now...
almost like a Grand Canyon. Actually.
Yeah, Grand Canyon. And now people go there. So, a lot of places that GHAC discovered initially is now, you know, places that most people frequent to. Even this place like Khajaguda, that was not known for people. So one of our leaders, Aleem Khadri, he went there first and that's how it got introduced. There are many places like Kondamatgu is there and a lot of hills around Yadiri Gutta. I remember also going to Jagithiyal and there I checked out the Google map. I saw a hillock there, I saw a lake and I went there. The police guy says that, you know, this area is not open for everybody. There is some combing happening over. Why did you come here? So he said, we are an adventure club, we would like to explore and all. So we were asking permission. So they said, at your own risk, we are not responsible. Then we took a local villager there and I scouted that area. It was a beautiful place. So a lot of such explorations. Then I was looking into history, a lot of history in terms of, you know, from the Qutub Shahi dynasty, the Bahmani kingdom, a lot of things that part of culture and adventure is there. And most of these forts were on hillocks. So there was adventure in our history as well, apart from Golconda. You have Koilkunda, you have Ganpur Fort, so many of these 10 to 12 forts around us, and you have Ratchakunda Fort. So these are destinations that I have been there, I love them. And the best feel is the beautiful rocks. And when you go there, you see these magnificent rocks, you can love them, you can hug them, you can stay with them. In this silence, they speak a lot to you, they speak to your heart. And when you stay there, they give you a stillness, they heal you with their energy. So I love these rocks, and most of the places around Hyderabad are rocks wherever you go, and this city is also blessed with rocks. Yeah, these are some of my favorite places.
In fact, Diyanath, another day we can take up the conversation ahead, because Hyderabad, Great Hyderabad Adventure Club is not just about trekking. We had various other events, like there's a rockathon that is done with Save the Rocks. There's other events like Mud Run that was done earlier, and then there's a rock climbing competition that was done at Shamirpet. Unfortunately, those rocks are gone forever now. But I'm sure that we will have a part two of this conversation definitely, and Diya would list out some places where you can go on trek. We will share some pictures with you, some videos with you, so that our viewers can know that it is a weekend is not just going to a mall or a cinema theater or to a restaurant, but taking your family out and going out. But one important consideration, and Diya, thank you very much for joining us. But I think as a closing remark, I think we need to give a list of do's and don'ts. I think something that people should not go on their own, they should be, because that is where a tragedy can happen. Many people are extremely confident about tackling nature. Remember, nature is bigger than you. Never mess with nature. It pays you back, and it pays you back so badly. So as we close this conversation, Diya, if you can just take us through a list of do's and don'ts for people who plan to go out and trek, especially the fact, don't go out alone, go with experienced people or go with clubs like GHSE.
Yeah, very important point, Suresh, especially for newcomers who are very excited about going outdoors, and also because a lot of movies are talking about, you know, hero heroines going out in the outdoors. So one important point is to know that nature never discriminates. Okay, it treats everybody equally, whether it's cold there, whether it's hot there. And when we go out to nature, there is inherent risk there. And you're going into someone else's territory. Okay, you're visiting somebody else's home. And when you go in nature, there could be a lot of reptiles out there. There could be mosquitoes and a lot of insects. There could be snakes, there could be scorpions, and the terrain will be very different. So always go in groups. The minimum safety thing that we say is go in groups of three. And if you're very new to trekking, go with a club. Okay. You definitely need some amount of experience and preparation. You need to carry the right amount of food, the right amount of water. You need to take breaks. And the biggest challenge is if you get lost. If you get lost, it will be very difficult to find your way back, because you will be moving in circles and circles at the same place. And you will get exhausted, you will get tired. That is where majority of accidents happen, when you run out of energy and you can no more stand either the temperature, or you give up your will and strength. So it's very important that we take these preparations, we take one step at a time, and few more considerations when we go out. One is, of course, the rule of three, that minimum three people are there. Inform where you're going and when you will come back. Because if you don't come back, people know where you have went, so that a search party come and rescues you. Or they can alert the nearest police station or whoever they can reach, so that people can reach to rescue. Anything can happen, you know, anything can happen. Even there were many times that I have lost, I had a fall. So, but because I have informed, you know, because I was prepared, I knew how to, you know, manage risk, I was able to do it. Here, every day, you know, some of these months where there are a lot of accidents happening, especially with newcomers, you know, who would go out to such places out of sheer excitement and overconfidence. They'll think that we'll be able to do it, and they will either lose their way, or, you know, sometimes what happens is they don't plan when to return back, and it becomes night. In the night, you lose.
And also water sources, I think, there isn't it? Rivers and all, people have this fashion of taking selfies nowadays. I think that's the most dangerous thing. You know, you never know when the stream will suddenly get water into it, and then people lose their way and start taking selfies and fall into the water. There have been numerous cases like that.
Yeah. A lot of deaths have happened by two cases. One is by fall, because people thought that they were able to climb, and they were not, not taking care of, not going close to the edges. And that's where they have fallen. Other thing is because they must have slipped on a slope that they were climbing. And then once you start rolling, you know, the momentum picks up and you reach out to the end, and that's very, very fatal. The second thing is people get into water. Okay, they think they are good swimmers because they have swum in the swimming pool. The lakes out there are very, very different. You don't know how that lake is, what is the depth, what is inside that lake. There could be, you know, a lot of debris inside, there could be a lot of plants inside, and people die in these two aspects. So water, always stay safe, don't get into it until you have someone who is trained as a lifeguard and there's somebody who can rescue you and something happens to you.
I think that's a great amount of advice from Diyanath. This is a part one of the video that we are doing with the Great Hyderabad Adventure Club. The part two will follow soon, and there we will have more specifics on different aspects of it. We will get more trek leaders to come in and tell you and teach you about it. So as Diya was mentioning, one thing is very, very important. Don't ever go alone. Go in groups. Even if you go in groups, take all the safety precautions. Don't get into water. Never be confident that you can handle heights. And places like Sahyadris, for example, in Maharashtra, when you climb, especially during the monsoons, you know, the steps are very, very steep and slippery. So unless you go with a club like the Great Hyderabad Adventure Club, definitely those trek leaders are, they know the place, they've been there, only then they are allowed to go. So they know the terrain like the back of the hand, and that's most important. Adventure is great, adventure is fun, it takes you closer to nature, it makes you appreciate it. But at the same time, please ensure that you stay safe. Thank you, Diyanath, for speaking to us at Hybris Conversations today, and it was wonderful hearing you. I'm sure that we will do part two soon.
Thank you, Suresh. Pleasure being here. I'm looking forward to part two, and this time I want to do it outdoors.
So, ladies and gentlemen and boys and girls, surely this is the bit that we wanted to tell you, because in everybody in Hyderabad asks, what is there for the weekend? Well, trek, go climb mountains, or even try some rapids. But stay safe, ensure that you look up the GHSE website, which is www.ghse.in, and then decide where to go. Thank you for watching.